negligible. And generally speaking, the front we are talking about here is in the surface layer, which has horizontal scale about a few hundred meters to 10 kilometers. And the vertical scale is approximately equal to mixed layer depths. All right, and it has a time scale around hours to days. And so this picture simply gives you an idea of how the front is. And the dynamic parameters, as you can see here, if you have front here, and you can have very strong lateral buoyancy gradient because you have strong density contrast here. And you can also have very strong vertical stratification, which is n squared there. And you probably already noticed that the m squared, I only consider dbdx. As I mentioned before, we don't consider the y direction because it's negligible. And the frontal jet here, as denoted by this red arrow, which basically gives you the vertical shear dz and horizontal shear dvdx, right? And those parameters are important, not only because they're telling us about the basic features of the front, they're also important because they are telling us about the stability of the flow, all right? So here is the condition for the flow instability. According to the auto PV theory, you have heard about it in the last few days. If we have auto PV being negative, we would say there will be the flow will be very unstable and instability will occur. In this talk, I will not classify which instability is going to be occur. We will only say the flow will be unstable. Okay, and as you can see, this auto PV includes those parameters that we mentioned up here. So we have to know all those parameters in order to know if the instability is going to be occur or not. And the more important question, why do we care about front if that is such a small portion compared to the large global ocean? The thing is that those instabilities will lead to turbulent mixing, and also it induces a strong vertical transport of tracers and nutrients. So I think there's one talk already mentioned that. I will quickly jump to the next one. I think this photo is very remarkable because it captures a frontal region where the birds are gathering in the frontal region where they go there to search for food. So this is the plume front, as you can see here. If you come closer, you can see those bubbles, which indicates the turbulent mixing. And then you zoom out, you can see those birds dancing up and down in this frontal region. So just give you a bit more biological perspective, how important it is. Okay, and more apart from biological perspective, we have another another importance, which is instability also leads to internal wave generation. That is more relevant to the audience here. So as you can see here, we have a front. We have less dense water on this side and dense water on this side. And these internal waves get generated when the front tends to retrace by. As you can see here, the less dense water going in this direction and the dense water going in this direction. And furthermore, later on, it gets this overturning circulation. And you can see those internal waves is propagating to both sides. And also in the interface between those two layers, you can also see some internal waves going on. And this is one of the mechanisms. There are so many. I only want to highlight there is possibility of generation of internal waves from the front. And what I'm going to cover today is the instability is in charge of forward energy cascades, which will trigger the energy mesoscale energy cascade downwards to some mesoscale energy and then small scale energy then dissipation. This is important, especially for TIR project, and that is also my part of PhD study. And let's see. So we have talked about so many importance of the front. That means there are so many studies have done such research in frontal region. And I should point out that those study mostly focus on nighttime condition. Why is that so? Because nighttime condition, which you have the surface cooling, which provides the perfect condition for the front to sustain. So you can have longer front stay there, and you can do your simulation or observation. That's why it's more work has done in nighttime condition. So here we have the B0, which is the atmospheric frequency flux. This is defined here. And B0, positive B0, here we define as frequency loss, which means surface cooling, and vice versa for solar heating if you have B0 being negative. All right. And another way of sustaining the front is through downfront winds. I think you probably already heard before. So that means the wind here, the wind stress is blowing in the direction of the frontal jet. In this situation, Ekman transport will lift the dense water over the light water, which resulting in intensifying the front. So that is also another way of sustaining the front. So in summary, the best condition for frontal dynamics is when you have total buoyancy flux. Oh, by the way, I need to mention that to quantify this Ekman forcing, we can use this Ekman buoyancy flux, which is proposed by Thomas in 2005 paper. Basically, what you need is a downfront wind tau y, and then the lateral buoyancy gradient m square. Then you can plug in all those constants here. You get your BE. If it's positive, then we are having downfront wind situation. If it's negative, then we have upfront wind, which the front would tend to be restricted. Okay, so we have the best condition if the total buoyancy flux B0 plus BE is positive. All right. However, people is largely ignoring when the front during the day, because they think if you have solar heating on top, the front is naturally collapse because there is no forcing to sustain it there. And in the following, I'm going to tell you this is probably not right. Okay, and in the following, I'm going to show you two fronts. The first one is based on the data collected from the Peng reliability system, which is supported by IOW. So you can see this is Peng reliability region. It's just near the Africa coast, the Namibia. And you can see how the filament is forming due to those mesoscale eddies and the cold water is transporting from offshore all the way to I don't know, probably 300 kilometer or 500 kilometer away on the coast. And we are going to talk about the front here. You can see this small line. And the instrument we are having for this transect is the microstructure profiler, which basically gives us the CTD in high resolution and also turbulence data. And the next front we are observing is from the Australian Northwest Shelf. As you can see here, this is Australia, and the star is where our study area is. And again, you can see mesoscale eddies turning around and making this front for our study purpose. All right, and for this area, we have one glider and one mooring. In addition to that, we also use atmospheric data and satellite data to support our study here. All right, I think I don't miss anything. Let's move on. So let's have a look, look at the first front that was observed at the Benguela Library system. So if we zoom in to this region, as you can see here, we can see the cold water is in the north and the warm water is in the south. And here is our transect. So this is the coordinates X and Y. Here we have the distance from 0 to minus 20, which corresponding to this figure here, it's minus 20 here and 0. And this density contrast is exactly reflected to M squared here in the blue, which means we have a little bit indication of the front. And the other lines are the buoyancy fluxes. We have B0 and BE and the total buoyancy flux here. So as you can see, this B0 is negative and it's largely dominated the total buoyancy flux, which means this transect was measured during the day when we have strong solar heating on top. Okay, and this is exactly opposite case of those previous studies that focus on perfect nighttime condition, nighttime and downwind conditions. We have opposite case here. And you may wonder what it looked like in the ocean. Here we have the microstructure data to see. Here I only show you the stratification and dissipation rate. All right. As you can see, this again is from 0 to minus 20 across the front. And here we have the depths in the y axis. And the n squared is large when it's darker. If it's weakly stratified, we have white color. And the same thing for stronger turbulence. And for weak turbulence, we have white color. All right, so basically we see is that when we have strong solar heating on top, we have this secondary thermocline formed within the surface mixed layer, which suppresses the turbulence underneath it. You can see there's barely no turbulence going on. And also there's no indication for strong frontal dynamics and turbulence in this case. So this is no surprise because people already expect that when we have solar heating, front will tend to be restratified and collapse in the end. No surprise, all right? And this is the case that's summarized in one of my JPO paper here. However, more surprising data set is here. So again, this is the front. If we zoom into this region, we see this big front and we have the mooring points in this location, the pink point. And then we have the glider go all the way from north to south across the front. And we have other instruments. I'm not going to talk about it today. Let's have a look what's going on in this region. Good, again, here we have four panels. The first one basically gives you the buoyancy fluxes and the M square, lateral buoyancy gradient. And here we have stratification, vertical shear, and turbulence data know, this is the estimated turbulence energy dissipation rate. So this is estimated by using this coupled mixing length model. This come very handy because you only need to measure high resolution of temperature and the shear and also salinity to give you this N squared. You can just plug in and you can get turbulence estimation without any turbulence, fancy turbulence instruments. However, this fails if the turbulence is not shear driven. Okay, so it's not telling you if turbulence is driven by, how much turbulence is driven by convective instabilities, for example. So we basically plug in all those parameters and get epsilon for those for these two depths as indicated by those dashed line. Okay, and one thing I also need to mention that as you can see, this mooring is covering to complete diurnal cycles. As you can see from this B0 here, this is one daytime, nighttime, daytime again. And basically what you see is when you have a little bit indication of front, you can see from this M square, the blue line, the mixed layer structure shows you nothing very interesting. It's just a classical view of oceanic surface mixed layer. What I mean is the stratification decreases during nighttime, and during daytime you have N square enhanced. This is normal and there's no shear. What we expect is that in the frontal region we have shear because of frontal jet. So this is, I would say this is the, okay, thank you. Yeah, this is in the beginning of the frontogenesis phase. What's important is the second phase where we have downfront wind. As you can see, this is a total buoyancy flux. Here we have positive, which means we are in this situation where we have the best condition for frontal instability. With that, we can calculate the ERTL PV, which shows here the red dots gives you where the condition for frontal instability are fulfilled. So basically you can see going down to here and there, and the turbulence remains high. So again, no surprise because this is nighttime condition and people already done that. What surprised me more is during the daytime when we have strong solar heating, but the frontal dynamics, I mean the shear and turbulence remain active. However, no evidence of frontolysis or frontal collapse happened. This is very surprised and we think about that for months why that's happened. Luckily, we have another data set which is from the glider observation. So if we have a look what happened in the glider data, one can see, I need to mention that the fun effect here is this happened in the noon on 7th of October. So we can see the noon of 7th October is here. If we zoom into this region, what we see is there is a diurnal warm layer sitting in the very surface, right? And it has a gradient, which is very large. By definition, this is so-called diurnal warm layer. However, it breaks down when the wind, here is the blue line, the wind gets stronger, then you basically break down the diurnal warm layers. And that led to a downward transport of the heat into deeper ocean. Okay, and with that, we can think about maybe this diurnal warm layer capturing in this location also exists in this location where we have active frontal dynamics and turbulence. With that, we propose a hypothetical coupled structure where we have upper diurnal warm layer and the lower frontal structure as shown here. what is going to happen is that once we have this structure, the surface forcing cannot penetrate into deeper layer of the surface next layer, which means it's blocked out from the surface, and that's why the frontal dynamics will sustain in the deeper layer. This is hypothesis. However, one cool thing is our glider data on the other day shows exactly the same pattern. So as you can see here, it's just one day before, we can exactly see there's a dino one layer sitting directly on the front. So this is one of our supports. And there are other supports already documented in my submitted paper. If you want to know more, when it's published, I can forward to you. And why I say there is a blocking effect by this dino worm layer, because if I calculate the N square, you can see this is super strong. And that stay in the surface layer. And that's how the surface buoyancy fluxes cannot go down into the deep layer, then the front still there. And everything is keep the same naturally. All right, so with the so basically the dynamic layer decouples the front from the surface forcing, that's allowing it to persist longer. With that, I can summarize when we have, we can summarize two scenarios for diurnal variability of semi-metal scale fronts. The first scenario we derive from the Peng operating system, where we have stronger wind that transports the heat downward to the deeper layer of the ocean, and that generates the secondary thermocline, and that make the frontal structure collapse. Okay, that's clear. The second scenario is when we have weak wind and the heat cannot be transported downwards, it stays in the surface. In this situation, the surface forcing cannot go into deeper ocean. That's why we have frontal structure and the interesting frontal dynamics going on in that deeper part of the mixed layer. And this is important because those two scenarios are most likely typical for sub or tropical oceans, because when you have solar heating and the front, you have this situation. And this scenario is likely to lead to significant differences in vertical fluxes, heat, and nutrient and gases. And so distinguish between those two scenarios is very important in terms of developing surface mixed layer parameterization for ocean and climate models, because dino worm layer is not well resolved in those models. Okay, I skip this one and this one, skip. Okay, thank you very much. So people always ask me what I have in Australia. Now I can tell you we have shear instability, blue sky, and a quad car.